I have often been asked this question. Mike, why is the Asia-Pacific Gulf Summit going to Brunei? My automatic response has always been, why not? It's one of the smallest nations in the Asia-Pacific, and it's a nation that has a passion for golf. And the mission of the Asia-Pacific Gulf Summit, when it was first started way back 6 years ago in Singapore, was to move the show from country to country, and hopefully at some point in time, it's not going to happen during my watch because I don't have very much time left, that it'll find a permanent home. But we're delighted to be here in Brunei, and the support that we've gotten from the authorities here has been outstanding. And I think all of you have felt it from the moment you got off the aircraft, right down the aero bridge, and it was hospitality, courtesy, and cordiality that's unmatched and unparalleled anywhere on this planet. So with that as background, yeah, come on, acknowledge them. We are now living in a brand new period in time, and it's called the Psi time. All right? I remember when I was a youngster, which was many moons ago, and when I saw Jack Kennedy, and Jack Kennedy delivering a speech, I was spellbound, you know, because historically it's always been old guys heading the most powerful nation on this planet. And all of a sudden to see a charming young guy with an engaging smile, you know, that was something. That signaled change big time. Then came along a fast-talking, glib pugilist by the name of Muhammad Ali. And he blew the world away. He was a fantastic change agent. And did he impact the world, not only in sport, but right across all spectrums of life. And then the famous Liverpudlians, the four guys who call themselves the Beatles. They change hairdos, they change the way we listen to music, you know, and the flower power generation of the 60s, you know, where those of us are still around today who freaked out on all sorts of funny substances. But thank God, you know, we're still around. And in the last couple of weeks or so, there was a sensation from Korea. You know, a very unlikely looking pop star. You know, a little tubby from Korea. But look at the way he's changed music. He has come in and revitalized an otherwise moribund music industry. Change, gentlemen and ladies. Psy, over 1 billion hits. He's going to make $8 million this year plus more. And I think Psy is going to be around for a little while. He's not a one-hit wonder. Let me tell you that. I was a disc jockey when I was a young man. I still have the ability to spot hits. And this guy is going to be around for a little while. So talking about change, there are going to be a couple of focus areas in this summit. The most important impacts all of what we do in terms of business. And one area of focus is going to be market intelligence. If I reached out now and said, Peter John, how many golf courses are there in Malaysia? Come on, answer. 200-odd, come on. How many golfers are there in Malaysia? 5 million? Yeah, you got to be kidding. You know, if it was 5 million, Rick Brown from Titleist should be selling a heck of a lot of golf clubs and golf balls. You get the message. Well, our market is not researched. You know, Asia is a disparate geography. We just don't have a fix in terms of the real number of golf courses, the number of golfers, the number of rounds played, you know. So invariably, a lot of us have our own little market intelligence, and by any stretch of the imagination, we're flying by the seat of the pants most of the time. So I think what we hope in the next couple of years is to start setting some benchmarks so that the golf industry can specifically say, yes, we are growing, or no, we are on a decline. At this point in time, we can't really say. All right? The only guys who are speaking positively about the growth of golf are a group of architects. Well, quite rightly so, because they've got some golf projects. But generally speaking, when I take a look at golf courses and when I sit around and talk to general managers in my rounds, you know, the feedback that I'm getting is not too encouraging. It's a global problem. You know, the problem varies in degrees from country to country. But generally speaking, we've got to make golf relevant. The next topic is the topic of sustainability. For the past 5 years, we've had guys come up on this lectern out here and talk about sustainability. And let me tell you this, I've not understood it. I understand what the word sustainable means. I understand what sustainability means. But how you apply it to the golf industry and make it work, I still don't understand it. So to solve that problem, we've brought out, you know, perhaps the most well-informed man on sustainability. His name is Ronald Dotson, the chairman of the International Sustainability Council, and he's going to tell us how it's done. The other area is the golf club experience. You know, the golf club experience has changed. I remember when I was a five-year-old, you know, my dad used to take me and my mom to the Singapore Island Country Club. He would go out with the boys. I used to be thrown into the sand pit to play with the kids. My mother used to go out and gossip with all the ladies, all right? But it was fun. At 3 o'clock in the afternoon, the driver would pick me up and my mom and send us back. My dad never came back home until about 11 o'clock. Happy as a bunny. All right, he had a great time, but we don't see that happening now. Get into most golf clubs, and by 6:30, 7 o'clock, it's dead. All right, so we want to see how we can collectively work together to bring back the club experience. Now.